You might fear spiders for their powerful venom, their sharp fangs, and the creepy way they scurry behind your furniture. But you can't deny their talent for building amazing structures.
For man to weave his great aerial highways of steel and concrete requires the combined work of hundreds of engineers. But the spider is endowed with the ability to perform an engineering feat that defies man's ability to fully comprehend.
From building their own flytraps, to knitting their silken transformation chambers, to creating hot air balloons out of thin thread,
we are entering the Age of Silk. Hi, I'm Danielle Dufault, and you're watching Animalogic Second Nature. The history and evolution of silk can be a complex web of misconceptions. So let's try to untangle it. Let's start with spiders.
There are an estimated 100,000 species of spiders throughout the world, each possessing a number of engineering skills that qualify him as a master craftsman.
Up to 1,000 times thinner than a strand of human hair, spider silk is pound for pound 5 times stronger than steel and tougher than Kevlar. Yet, if a single strand were stretched around the entire Earth, it would weigh less than 500 grams.
One of the few things lighter than spider silk is Opera, which is the web browser that we used while writing and researching this episode.
Opera is really awesome. I like it for doing research because it lets you organize and group your tabs into tab islands. I feel that if you have too many tabs open, it gets overwhelming, but having the option to separate them however you like makes it easier. For example, here's all my tabs about silk, separate from all my other stuff. And when I'm reading and need some quick answers, I love using a feature called Aria, which is an AI chat connected directly with a browser that gives you answers immediately. I got curious and used it to see if it would be possible to make a dress out of spider silk, and it seems in theory it is. How cool would that be? You can also highlight words to get quick definitions and explore subjects further.
Opera also has an inbuilt ad blocker and a VPN. You don't need extra extensions to work.
These two features help you have a private and comfortable experience. Pages load faster, it hides your location for private browsing, and it's completely free and unlimited.
And if you're not working and just want to have fun, there's a lot of insanely smart features that just make everything easier.
There's a customizable sidebar for your music player and social media accounts, so you can have all your social media accounts connected and listen to music without having to go to their websites. And also, when you're watching videos, you can make them pop with Lucid Mode, which sharpens them. See the difference?
I love Opera, and I'm sure you will too. Please click on the link in the description to see how much better your browsing experience can be. And now back to the amazing animals who use sticky thread to control their world. Not all webs stick the same. Some webs stick to insects with droplets of glue. Other webbing clings to insects' hair and legs like cotton threads of a shirt to a burr. So there's a lot of variety out there.
Some spiders will station themselves in the center of the web. Others, however, keep hidden nearby. When the trap is sprung, the vibrations of the insect's struggles are carried to the spider, which immediately rushes out to subdue its prey and carefully package it up for a future meal.
It's estimated that spiders eat between 400 and 800 million metric tons of insects every year. For comparison, the entire human population consumes approximately 400 tons of meat and fish during the same time. That's a whole lot of web catching going on.
Speaking of which, there are 5 basic types of spider webs.
First, we have sheet webs. You've probably seen these if you go for a hike in the woods or across a field or marsh. Most commonly associated with the members of the Linifidae family, like the platform spider, sheet webs are flat sheets of silk spun between blades of grass or branches. The spider spins a net of webbing above the sheet. When flies hit the net, they bounce onto the sheet webbing and are caught in the trap.
Another type of web is tangle webs, or cobwebs. Not to be confused with the dusty webs that collect in the corners of your room.
These are made by many spiders in the Theridiidae family, like the house spider and the notorious Black Widow.
She encases her victims with silk and then kills with poison from her fangs. The widow's web is irregular and without apparent design.
Tangle webs are a messy, disorganized jumble of threads that are laced with sticky droplets. When an insect crawls across a thread, it breaks, drawing the unsuspecting victim up in the center of the tangle, where it becomes hopelessly entangled.
Then we have the triangle and funnel webs.
The first is a triangular web, where the spider releases a coil of silk that entangles its prey. And the second is a funnel-shaped structure of silk. The spider hides in the small end of the funnel and waits for prey insects to stumble into their doom.
And last, the web we all know and love, the popular and ever-romanticized spiral orb web.
Her gossamer highways bridge leafy chasms with almost invisible ropes of silk, each of incredible strength.
There are close to 3,000 species of orb weaver spiders. Their webs are typically found outside and are the most common and popular type of spider web. No matter the species, spiders are highly skilled engineers. They create amazingly complex webs using a gland called a spinneret.
She can spin a single strand, a heavy cable, or a broad band. The silk may be elastic or non-elastic, sticky or unsticky, colored or transparent.
The spinneret is located at the bottom of its abdomen and allows the spider to produce a variety of silk used for different purposes, like for webbing, creating drop lines, cocooning prey, protecting eggs, and flying.
Wait, what? Yes, spiders can fly, sort of. This peculiar arachnid pastime is actually called ballooning, and it's another amazing thing that its silk is used for.
Spiders go ballooning by climbing to a high up, open area. They raise their two front legs to check the wind speed and possibly direction. And then they raise their abdomen skyward, releasing threads of webbing into the air, kind of like a parachute. When a breeze comes along, they float away.
Seems pretty simple, right? Well, the process is a lot more complex than it looks. Ballooning spiders are actually using electrostatic repulsion by using the Earth's electric fields to take flight.
When they release their silk, the threading becomes negatively charged and repels against the negatively charged surface they're sitting on. This makes the spider balloon upwards.
Scientists believe that spiders have evolved to go ballooning for a variety of reasons, like escaping predators or finding new sources of food. But their fun-loving ways weren't always the case. The early ancestors of spiders couldn't even spin webs.
It was only recently that scientists finally found the spider's missing link, its long-extinct, silk-producing, but not web-spinning ancestors, collectively known as proto-spiders. The most famous of these is Atercopus fimbriungus.
It lived around 400 million years ago, a time before the first tree ever lived.
They weren't really spiders yet. A proto-spider, like Chimera arachne yingi, had a tail, and it wasn't able to spin webs like a spider that uses spinnerets.
By this point, flying insects hadn't evolved, so there was no need for a proto-spider like Atercopus fimbriungus to go to higher ground and spin webs in taller plants, because there wasn't anything flying up there.
All the prey was on the ground. The silk was also used to line their nests, create homing trails, and protect egg sacs.
Evolution doesn't work in a vacuum. Everything works together. And once insects took flight, we believe that Atercopus fimbriungus evolved.
Its spigots, that were not very precise, adapted to spinnerets. And then they were up in trees spinning intricate webs. And that's how the modern spider was born.
But as new species appear, some evolve completely new hunting techniques, while others stay closer to their ancestors' behavior.
For instance, as mentioned previously, funnel spiders spread blankets of webbing across the grass and other vegetation, just like Atercopus fimbriungus. This has led scientists to think that sheet webs are the type of web that's ancestral for all spiders.
The questions that surround evolution and the development of specific tools and traits in arachnids are fascinating and complex. but one of the more recent and awesome instances of arachnid evolution occurred not that long ago.
Decoy spiders are learning to use debris and the carcasses of their prey to create dummy versions of themselves. Some of these decoys even have the right number of legs.
Apart from the spooky idea that spiders may be able to count, the most amazing thing was
that decoy spiders all over the world are learning to do the same thing independently, with one sighting in Peru and another 12,000 miles away in the Philippines. An amazing case of convergent evolution.
But some of the most interesting spider adaptations are happening closer to home, right in our cities, because of human-induced rapid environmental change. Researchers are discovering that cities are actually making spiders grow bigger and multiply faster.
Well, say Minneapolis or Cincinnati or New Orleans. I mean, a city of half a million busy inhabitants.
Spiders removed from inner city parks weighed three times as much as those taken from bushland areas. They also discovered that the city spiders' ovaries were significantly bigger than those from rural areas.
This adaptation is likely due to an increase in temperature and food availability in the city. And boy, are spiders ever changing their food habits. Part of it has to do with getting over their fears.
Spiders are historically photophobic, meaning that they have an extreme sensitivity to light. That's why they like hanging out in dark, creepy places. But researchers have recently discovered that city spiders are rapidly losing their photophobia. City spiders are building webs around streetlights to catch more prey at night, and more than their rural counterparts, which is totally changing the food chain game. But we expect no less from such an amazingly adaptive ambush predator as the spider.
An adaptation as helpful as silk is bound to convergently evolve in several species. Other than arachnids, insects are the animals most commonly associated with silk.
Here we see mulberry leaves being fed to young silkworms. The domestic silkworm would soon perish if protected and fed.
Silkworms are the larvae of the moth Bombyx mori, which is the domesticated version of wild silk moth. Larvae produce silk to build their cocoons, where they metamorphose into moths.
5,000 years ago, they were domesticated in China. The artificially selected new species requires human help to survive, but it can also make a lot of silk.
Domesticated silkworms eat more, grow faster, get larger, and build bigger cocoons. A single silkworm can make a thread 300 to 900 meters long to build its cocoon. But the thread is so fine that you need over 2,000 cocoons to make a pound of silk. Over 10 billion cocoons are harvested worldwide each year to make shiny clothes.
More than 4,000 years ago, so the legend claims, Chinese hands acquired the skill of weaving the silken thread. Thus is beauty created from threads of the fragile cocoons of silkworms that feed on the tender leaves of mulberry trees of the valley.
But though these moths are the most prodigious silk cocoon builders, there are hundreds of insect species to do the same in various degrees of sophistication.
Raspy crickets make shelters with silk very similar to that of silkworms, but they evolved this adaptation independently. Similarly, bulldog ants, web spinners, silverfish, flies, and many moths and butterflies use silk to protect themselves when at their most vulnerable. Honeybees even have silk glands in their mouth that they use when building their wax cells to pupate. This silk is tougher and stretchier than silkworm silk, and it's being studied for usage in the medical field.
The web spinner is the closest silk-producing animal to Spider-Man. Their silk glands are located in their forelimbs, and they shoot it into walls.
But in their case, it's not for catching bad guys, it's for building homes. Yep, this strange little guy lives in large homes draped in silk. Luxurious.
They would be runners-up for the award for Best Silk-Based Engineering. The gold goes to the amazing weaver ant.
Weaver ants build their colonies in the tree canopy, attaching tree leaves to each other to build protective chambers. Their name comes from the way they glue the leaves together.
Their larvae naturally make silk to make a cocoon. But since they're already safe enough in the colony, the adults use their sticky silk as their version of concrete.
The larvae are held in the workers' mandibles and are softly squeezed, while the workers move back and forth from one leaf to another. They'll continue with this process with several leaves until a ball of leaves as big as a volleyball is created.
But that's not all. In the ocean, Pinna nobilis are the main producers of sea silk.
They're mussels, up to 60 centimeters tall, that secrete silk to attach themselves to rocks or the seabed. The silk is strong enough to be used to make cloth, even though each individual strand is only about 6 centimeters long. This mat of strands is known as a byssus, and is common in several species of pen shells, true mussels, and freshwater mussels.
Silk is for sure more of an invertebrate animal feature, but there are a couple of vertebrate species that are learning from our invertebrate friends.
Carp have sticky silk that they use to hold their eggs together and glue them to the rocks or plants. Many fish species have similar behaviors and lay their eggs in sticky rafts, so this isn't that unusual. But this is.
Spider goat. It lives, it breathes, and it's here to shoot silk out of its udders. They're genetically modified goats that have an orb weaver spider gene in the milk producing area of their DNA.
Their milk is full of silk proteins, and it can then be processed to extract all the silk. This is an emerging area of research, but if successful, it can be a much more efficient way to get strong silk to repair ligaments and other medicinal purposes.
There is silk all over the animal world, and its convergent evolution sheds light on the evolution of animal shelter building, trap making, and tool use.
The spider forms her bolus by rolling up a little ball of sticky silk, which she hangs from the end of a strong silken line. Then she pulls herself up to a vantage point, catches hold of the bolus, and prepares to cast it at the first insect that comes within range.
What mysteries of evolution do you want me to explore next week? Please let me know in the comments and be sure to subscribe for new episodes every week. Thanks for watching. See you next time.